So today I want to start by talking about Ryle, and then we're going to move on to Carnap's testability and meaning. Let's begin with Ryle and this idea of expressions that are systematically misleading. What do we mean, systematically misleading expressions? The last time at the very end, I gave you a hint about what a systematically misleading expression is. It's really an expression that has a certain surface form, a grammatical form, but then also has a deep underlying logical form, and those two are different. So it is fundamental, really from Frege on, to assume that sentences have a logical form, and that those logical forms don't necessarily match the overt forms of things in English. So there's a distinction, which starts with Frege, I think, but extends through contemporary linguistic theory, that there is a surface structure to a sentence, which is revealed basically by syntax. But then there's an underlying deep structure, which is revealed by semantics. Now, what do those terms mean exactly? Well, syntax is the theory of grammar, basically, and so its major objective is to determine the basic structures of things and understand which sentences are grammatical, to characterize the class of grammatical sentences. And it does that by analyzing these structures, but it often then proposes some level of deep structure, and then semantics provides a theory of meaning to go along with that. So I shouldn't just say semantics here. Really, this is sort of syntax plus semantics. It's a question of, well, what is the structure that the syntax reveals? And then we look underlying that structure at what this might mean. So often, for example, this gets identified with logical form. And the logical form is something that reveals, you might say, the underlying meaning of the sentence, matches meaning. And so in a semantic theory, you might really start with logical forms, or you might start with surface structures, use some syntactic theory to get you something like a logical form, and then give a theory of meaning for those logical forms. So the way in which this gets divided up can vary from theory to theory. I don't want to suggest that there's a really clean line to be drawn. And in fact, in linguistics, it's a major issue. How do you draw the line between syntax and semantics? And similarly, how do you draw the line between semantics and pragmatics, the theory of use? But for now, we're going to not worry about that, really, because in Ryle, this isn't very precisely worked out at all. This is what he's calling the grammatical form. And it's distinguished from the logical form. And the question is really, what is the relationship between these two? What's the relationship between the surface structure and the deep structure, between the grammatical form and the logical form? Now, sometimes Ryle thinks these match up very nicely, okay? In which case, you've got an expression that, you might say, wears its meaning on its sleeve, is right there, and its structure is clear. So think about a sentence like, this is white. Okay, that seems to be of subject-predicate form. And indeed, it's not just that way in the surface syntax. The underlying logical structure is precisely, he thinks, that this stands for an object, and then is white is something that expresses a predicate of that. And so this sort of object-having property, subject-predicate form, those match really nicely. So that's an example of an expression that's not systematically misleading, utterly clear. But he thinks quite often the surface structure and the deep structure don't match. And that if you take a sort of, I guess we could say naive approach to surface structure, you end up thinking there's a deep structure that there really isn't. Often by assimilating what's going on to this sort of simple case where they match, like this is white. And so, although Ryle doesn't mention this, well, he does sort of in a paragraph where he says, yeah, people who talk about being or things like that are the worst. In the background is Heidegger as a kind of villain. Okay, Heidegger is the one who is supposedly going around saying all these meaningless things. And it's true that at certain points, Heidegger says things that suggest this. One of his famous statements, for example, in an essay on metaphysics is that nothingness, nothings, das Nichts. And actually, a lot of the logical empiricists get excited about that and think,
That's ridiculous. Okay, that's utterly preposterous. That has no meaning. But as we'll see, it's not just things like that. It's much broader than that. But that's a case where they say, look, that looks like a simple subject-predicate sentence. But actually, nothing, or nothingness, or the nothing, that doesn't stand for anything, first of all. And secondly, what do you mean, it nothings? That's not even actually syntactically well-formed here. Now, I don't necessarily mean to endorse the criticism of Heidegger here. It's just that that's an example of the kind of thing they think of as utterly meaningless. But there are all sorts of things, as we'll see, where these don't match. So a systematically misleading expression is one where the surface structure doesn't match the deep structure, and in fact misleads us about it, makes us think it's something other than what it is. So what are some examples of things that are systematically misleading, where the underlying logical form is very different from the surface form?
Nothing is red.
Ah, okay, good. Yeah, think about a case like that. Nothing is red. Now, suppose we think that's something like, this is white. Then we're going to say, ah, this is a simple subject-predicate sentence. So this is our subject, that's our predicate. And so just as with this is white, this must stand for an object. And there it is. I'll draw it as a big zero since it's nothing. And then I'm saying it's red. And sadly, I only have white chalk, so I can't color it in red. But it might look like that's what it's about, right? This sentence is about nothing. And it's predicating redness of nothing. But of course, that's not what it means. What does nothing is red really mean?
An absence of red.
An absence of red. Yeah, I mean, the way this would get translated into first order logic from Frege on, at any rate, is something like, look, there is, it is not the case. That there is an X such that X is red. Okay, or in logical symbols, you might say, you know, it's not the case that there is an X such that X is red. And that doesn't look anything like this. There's no subject in particular, right? Nothing expresses some sort of quantificational expression. It says something like, it's not the case that there is something. Or you could say, everything is such that it is not red. That would be an alternative and equivalent translation. But in any event, whether you think of it this way or this way, it is not a simple subject-predicate sentence. And so something involving nothing like this is a systematically misleading expression. So we don't have to go as far as Heidegger's sort of weird statements about nothing or nothingness. Just an ordinary statement. And you might think, well, nothing is red. That's obviously false. But substitute in something that's true. You know, nothing is both round and square. That's true. And the underlying form of that is going to be nothing like this. So, in short, it's going to be the case that anything involving nothing or a lot of other quantificational expressions. We can have something is red, and similarly, something is not the name of something. It is a quantificational expression. So, this is a good example. Anything that involves, well, I'll just stay with the language of logic here. Anything that is a quantificational expression is going to be one where the everything, something, nothing, etc., is not just referring to an object, even though the surface form might look like it is. What are some other examples? Yeah?
God exists.
God exists. Ah, okay, yes. So we've got that as one case. Various claims about existence or reality are going to be the same way. So let's think about God exists. You might think that sentence is a simple subject-predicate form, like this is white. And so you'd say, well, what is it about? How do we think about it? Well, there's this object, God, and I won't risk blasphemy by putting anything in. But I can't leave it this blank. There's got to be something there, right? That's the problem. So I'll just draw something, wow, fuzzy and infinite. Okay? And then, exists, we might think, okay, that's a predicate that's applying to the object. Now, Ryle doesn't like that analysis at all. Why doesn't he like it?
Because
What's wrong?
It's contrary, doesn't make any sense.
God doesn't exist? Ah, suppose we think about a claim like that. Here we've got the theist saying God exists. Now we've got the atheist saying God doesn't exist. You might think, ah, well, okay, I know how to picture that. That's a claim about God. Namely, that God does not exist. But you might think, wait, that can't be right. Because after all, that makes this seem self-contradictory. It's saying something about God, namely that God doesn't exist. But you might think at first glance, wait, that's really weird, right? Because there has to be this thing that you're saying doesn't exist. Makes it sound as if there's something self-contradictory about that. And of course, you might think, well, but look, it's just a negation here, right? That's just, it's not the case that God exists. However, if we say God is unreal, or God is a fiction, or God is only imaginary, or something like that, then it looks like, again, we're predicating something of an object. But that contradicts the very nature of what somebody's trying to say. And so, Ryle thinks, yeah, existence can't be viewed as a predicate in this way. And actually, he uses this also as an argument that we can't understand God as a name. In fact, the same thing is going to be true of Othello, of Santa Claus, of all sorts of names, right? I mean, it's not just God. It's not just when we start thinking about religion that we're going to run into these issues. There are all sorts of things we might talk about. And in fact, it might be an open question. People can debate whether King Arthur, for example, really existed. And we don't logic to pre-decide the question. Did King Arthur exist? Might be saying, ah, okay, that question is supposing there's an object, King Arthur. And now the question is, did he exist? It's kind of like, did he really have a round table? But no, Ryle's saying, it's not like that at all. You're asking whether there is such an object. And now anyway, there are two things that emerge here. One is that existence or reality or their denials, those mustn't simply be predicates applied to objects. But secondly, he says, that it's going to follow that names like this aren't really naming things. Names have to be understood as descriptions, okay? And so in this way, to some extent, he's got Russell in the background. He doesn't go into the details. And in fact, in the last paragraph, he says, yeah, a lot of people talk about complexes and symbols. And he's really referring to Russell. He says, I don't know if I understand any of that stuff. Presumably what I've said has something to do with that. But actually, he's getting a lot of this from Russell. And here, he's using a kind of Russellian argument that these names have to be descriptions. So things involving proper names are also going to be vocabulary. And we've already sort of seen how that's going to be the case. They are really going to stand in for some kind of description, presumably. Yeah?
Why is it that if the statement God doesn't exist doesn't make sense, then the statement God exists also doesn't make sense? Like, why does the problem with the contrary also apply to the original proposition?
Oh, well, he thinks if you analyze it in this way, yeah, it does. It makes this a tautology and this a contradiction somehow. And it's not just some feature of God here. It's not like there's a hidden ontological argument. The same thing would be true of King Arthur. King Arthur exists. It would be saying, ah, that's predicating something of King Arthur. But he ends up saying, no, that's not what it's doing. And similarly, King Arthur didn't exist. That's not predicating something of King Arthur. It's doing something different. Now, what are they doing? Well, the thought is there's a kind of description. And so, really, this is something like the claim, there is a being who, and now, fill in whatever the description would be associated with God exists. And similarly with this, we'd say, aha, that's really, there is no being. Or there is, I guess I should say, strictly keep the form up. It is not the case that there is a being. So if you say Dan Bonnebeck is my professor in the analytic tradition, it's like, well, wait a minute, you're not predicating something of Dan Bonnebeck. Instead, you're saying there is a being who, and now what? In the case of God, we might have some idea of what kind of description somebody has in mind, the perfect being, the necessary being, or something like that. What would be the description that goes along with Dan Bonnebeck? Afraid to hear the answers to this one.
Couldn't you just say professor of analytic philosophy?
Yeah, it could be that. There is a being who teaches analytic philosophy, and he's my professor. Notice what happens there if we do that, though. Ah, the person who is my professor in analytic philosophy is my professor in analytic philosophy. And so that turns that statement into something that feels very much like a tautology. It's kind of like saying the king of France is the king of France. And so that becomes sort of weird. It depends a lot on what description you take. It might just be the being named Dan Bonnemack, okay? And there, what you're using is the name Dan Bonnemack, and not the sort of person being named that gets invoked. But of course, this leads us to the next problem. If that's true, what about descriptions themselves? Well, descriptions are also systematically misleading. Because after all, that he takes it as the point of Russell's on denoting. If I say the present king of France is bald, I am not positing an object, the present king of France, and then saying that object is bald. As I would be if I were saying, Jonathan Dancy is bald. And then suppose there's an object, Jonathan Dancy, and describe him as bald. In this case, no, the present king of France is bald means something different, right? And so, the thought is, to go back to Russell, well, really it's this threefold plane. There is a king of France, there's only one king of France, and every king of France is bald, okay? And so, now here he says something weird though. Russell gives you that analysis, right? So Russell essentially says, look, the F is G means this. There is an F. There is only one F, or really at most one F, I guess I should say. And then you could say some or every or that F is G. The sum every that will all be equivalent because in the end there's only one F. There's exactly one F and it is G. But now Ryle says something surprising, un-Russellian, when he's talking about this. He says there's a difference between saying Tom is not the king of England and Poincaré is not the king of France. Now why does he think there's a difference? Tom is not the king of England.
Because there actually was a king of England at the time?
Yeah, exactly. So he's thinking, aha, when I say Tom is not the king of England, I am supposing there is a king of England. And I'm saying Tom is not him. Okay? So that means something like there is one and only one king of England, but Tom is not that guy. Whereas Poincaré is not the king of France can't mean that. I don't mean there is one and only one person who's king of France and Poincaré is not that guy. I mean, it is not the case that there is one and only one king of France, and Poincaré is that guy. Now, how could Russell explain that difference? A lot of you are squinting and smiling, otherwise giving me facial expressions that indicate you don't have a clue what to say. And some of you look actually hostile. However, it's not a big deal from Russell's point of view, right? Because Russell, remember, said there's a scope distinction. What am I negating? If I say somebody is not the king of France, or the king of France is not bald, what do I mean? I might mean there is an F, and there's at most one F, and that F is G. Or rather, let me say, there is exactly one F, and that F is not G, if I'm denying this. Or I might mean it's not the case that these three things are true at the same time. He draws a distinction between primary occurrences of the definite description and secondary occurrences. And so that's always going to be the case. We always get an ambiguity out of a definite description. Even if I say the chalk is white, well, in that case, it's not a problem. It's when I negate it or put it in terms of another operator that I get an ambiguity. So if I say it is not the case that the chalk is red, I might, since I'm using the definite description, the chalk, be implying that there is one and only one piece of chalk I'm talking about anyway, and that is not red. Or I might be saying that it's not the case that there is one and only one piece of chalk I'm talking about, and that thing is red. Okay, the not can, as it were, go on the outside here, or it can go on the inside. And so there's just an ambiguity. And so if you're saying Tom is not the King of England, Russell would say, it always has these two meanings. But in that case, you probably have background information, there is a King of England. And so you assume that, you know, the guy is assuming there is such a person, and you're just saying Tom is not that person. On the other hand, in the case of the King of France, you're not assuming that. In fact, background information is there is no King of France. And so if you say Poincaré is not the King of France, you don't have that. The not is coming on the outside. So anyway, it seems to me weird that Ryle says what he says. But this is only the beginning of the weirdness, the first hint of the weirdness. Okay? Well, actually, there are a lot of hints of weirdness already, but forget that. First really obvious one. What are some other things that he describes as systematically misleading? Yeah.
Wait, so does Ryle agree with Russell that it kind of doesn't matter that there's some ambiguity there?
Well, he doesn't really explain what he's talking about. He seems to suggest that the underlying, although the grammatical form of Tom is not the King of England and Poincaré is not the King of France seem identical, they have different logical forms, which indicates to him that there's something systematically misleading going on. I think Russell would say, well, look, it's just the same systematic misleadingness that's true in every description, in that there are really these multiple claims underlying the use of the description. And then, yeah, once you recognize this is what's going on, introduce another operator like not, and you've got all sorts of things, you know, not, that are now going to be ambiguities. In both of those cases, I think Russell would say both of those sentences are ambiguous, and to figure out what you mean, would have to start asking you questions about what you know about the kings of France and England and so on. Yeah.
Well, I understand that when you have the not operator, but why does that mean that descriptions without that extra operator would be ambiguous?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, they're not. So if I just say the chalk is white, there's no ambiguity
right
in that. It's only when I put in, because that just says, yeah, there's one and only one piece of chalk and it's white.
So would Ryle say that that's still systematically misleading? The chalk is white?
I think so, because here's what he's thinking, really. He's thinking, okay, the chalk is white. What's going on there? He thinks the surface form makes it look like this is very simple. The chalk, aha, here it is. And then is white, is predicating something of that object. But I think he's saying that's not the logical form of this. The logical form is something like this. There is exactly one piece of chalk and it is white. And so even that is systematically misleading in that it has a much more complicated depth structure, logical form than you might initially think. But it's not, in that case, it's not ambiguous until we start putting it in with other operators. So yeah, put in belief, put in knowledge, put in negation, anything like that, and all of a sudden we see the ambiguities. But yeah, even here, there's something misleading about it in that it implies that the subject predicate form of the sentence matches a sort of object property form in the logical form. And he says, that's not right. What are some other examples?
Weird adjectives attached to things.
Weird adjectives, good. What's an example of a weird adjective?
Possible mayor.
Possible mayor, yes. Okay, good. So we get a variety of adjectives that he thinks don't fit into this. What number am I on? Five. We've got certain adjectives. Now you might think, look, what an adjective is doing is standing for some property, but he says, actually, this isn't always right. So we've got somebody as described as the possible mayor. What are some other examples of things that work weirdly?
Fake news.
Fake news, yes, good. Others?
Potential candidate.
Potential candidate, yes. Actually, he doesn't list this one, but one that I think is like this is large. A large, yeah, city.
I feel like broken hammer.
Broken hammer. Okay. Now, what's weird about these?
Yeah, how are those last two weird?
Oh, okay, yes, good.
Most adjectives work like this. Okay, if you've got some things that satisfy some noun, so you've got some noun like mayor, news, candidate, city, hammer, or whatever, and then you've got a group of things that satisfy the adjective, and you end up saying, well, what does this mean? It means to pick out the set of things that satisfy the adjective and the noun. And so it's a question of characterizing that intersection. Now, a lot of adjectives do work that way. A white piece of chalk is white and a piece of chalk. In fact, most adjectives work this way. Adjectives that work like this are called intersective adjectives. Because if you apply them to a noun, you just get the intersection between the extension of the adjective and the extension of the noun. Okay, the things that would make the adjective true and the things that make the noun true, or that the noun would be true of, and the adjective true of. But some are not like that. Okay, so sometimes, in notice that this picks out some subset of the things that satisfy the noun. And so whenever that is true, we could say this is also subsetive. It picks out some subset. Well, adjectives can be only subsetive without being intersective, or they can be neither. So, what's an example of this? Yeah. The simplest thing are the ones that are neither. So, possible mayor, fake news, potential candidate. Is a potential candidate a candidate?
Maybe.
Maybe, but not necessarily, right? Fake news, is that news? No. Possible mayor. Mayor? Maybe, right? Not necessarily. So notice what's happening here. Actually, this seems stronger than the others. This actually suggests, look, it's not a subset. If we take the class of fake news, it doesn't overlap the class of news at all, you might think. Possible mayor? Well, yeah, shoot. Actually, I guess I should say with all of these, it's not a subset. What I really should be saying in addition is that in this case, it doesn't seem, I mean, it seems like it's a disjoint set altogether. It doesn't even overlap this. Now, what's weird about these? Well, actually, maybe broken hammer is like this too, right? If the hammer is broken, it's not really a hammer anymore. You can't use it to hammer. So maybe that's similar to that. Why did I put large city here? Well, because large seems relative to this. So large is an example of something that is subsective without being intersective. Okay? Most of the things we've listed here aren't intersective at all, and aren't subsective. This, however, is subsective. A large city is a city. But now why do I say it doesn't work the same way? Actually, here's a simpler case. I'm going to draw a mouse. Now, he's a mouse, and I'm going to say, he's a large mouse. Well, all mice are animals, so he's also an animal. Is he a large animal? No. Right? So one way to see this is, suppose something is a town. It's a large town. But then you say, well, I could refer to it as a city, it's sort of a city too, but is it a large city? Maybe not. Large city means something like large for a city. Large mouse, large for a mouse. The metric of what's big and what's small depends on what I predicated on. And so I can't treat large as just something like this that intersects something else. Instead, large seems tied to that in its meaning. And all sorts of things like small, right, big, average size, typical. You are, for example, let's say, a student. And let's suppose you're a typical student. So is you're also an American. Does that make you a typical American? No, right? Typical is something that ties into the meaning of that in the same sort of way. And so in all of these cases, he thinks, yeah, there's something weird. We tend to think of adjectives and nouns together as just simply intersecting those two things. But in lots of cases, that's not what's going on. So he treats those as systematically misleading. What are some other examples?
personal identity things, like, I mean, kind of like if you retired doctor, something like that.
Retired doctor. Is a retired doctor a doctor?
They're not practicing. Or if you
a former president.
If you had children and your child tragically passed away, are you still a parent?
Right, right. Okay, good. A lot of things seem temporally indexed in that way too. So that's different from large, which seems to sort of be a relative thing connected to that set somehow. Some things vary with time, and so you're right. A retired doctor, maybe, you know, former president, president-elect is not yet the president, et cetera, et cetera. So a lot of these are temporal things.
Madam Secretary, you're calling these people Madam Secretary, Mr. President for 50 years after they were actually doing something that they did for 4 years. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, right. So that's interesting. People do tend to think of former presidents still as presidents, but it doesn't necessarily go the other
way. Way more time not being president.
Well, you do that with the military, yeah. Too.
Like, true.
That's true. Once you're a retired general, you're still a general. So, yeah, right. So that it is weird how these things connect to times varies a lot from adjective to adjective. Anyway, there are a variety of other categories he talks about here. I don't want to go through details in all of them, but one involves mental terms. And so what I mean by that is things like talk of ideas, thoughts, and he thinks, moreover, propositions is like this. He says all of those are things that actually mean something else. Suppose I say, ooh, he and I had the same idea at the same time. What would that mean? Does that actually commit us to the existence of ideas? Actually, I complicated that because the same idea that's got identity and a description in it and so on, so maybe that's bad. But suppose I say, I have an idea. Why does he think that's misleading? There is some X such that X is an idea and I have it. That seems to commit us to the existence of objects like ideas. But he doesn't like that. What does he think it means if I say, I have an idea? Yeah. What about this case? I have a thought. Somebody says, you know, you're discussing some problem. Somebody says, I have a thought. What does that mean?
It's an example of Russell's two verb problems. I think that some description.
Yeah, I think that something, right? Certainly idea. I'm thinking about something, maybe. But now that's not a whole lot better because that seems to imply that I should be able to fill that. There is something such that I'm thinking it, etc. He thinks there's a way of translating all of these things. And the same thing is true of meanings. What's the meaning of that sentence? That's really, he thinks, something we can get rid of. To say this sentence and that sentence have the same meaning is not to commit ourselves to meanings. It's just to say that sentence is equivalent to that sentence. But thoughts, ideas, propositions, that's a little more complicated. Yeah?
One question I have about meanings, I've been paying attention recently to when I or people say things like, I made the same mistake twice.
Right, yes, good.
So if you make the same mistake twice, what does that actually mean? Usually people say that when like, oh, I dropped my hat, and then I dropped my hat again.
Right.
I made the same mistake twice. You just made this. I think of that as making the same mistake.
Right. Okay, good. And that seems like it commits you to the existence of mistakes, right? If we say, what is there in the world? Russell says, sense data, the absolute ideal, say, the world spirit. A scientific realist says, atoms, and, you know, the particles that make up atoms. And then somebody might say, oh, but don't forget mistakes, because I make them all the time. In fact, you might say, what are you best at making, you know? Just ask the craftsman to you, and you say, mistakes. I produce them by the bucket load. You might think, wait a minute, there's something weird going on there. And indeed, I think that would fall under a different category here. He thinks of events as being things that are kind of like this. The Battle of Waterloo. defeated Napoleon. It's not that an event defeated anyone, he would say. It's that's really a way of saying that Napoleon lost at Waterloo, removed him from power, or something like that. And so there are lots of things, and I think mistakes might be, in effect, a category of events or actions that are like this. Now, oh, the last one I wanted to mention like this are abstract terms. So things like virtue or whiteness, justice, those are things that seem to be talking about an object, an abstract object, something like a property or a kind or a Platonic form, something like that. But he says, no, 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 don't be misled. It's not talking about an object. To say some courage is a virtue is just to say courageous actions are virtuous. Okay? And so there, these things can all be translated into terms that aren't really talking about the abstractions at all. Well, now notice in all of these cases, what he's doing is saying, there is some way of translating these. We don't have to be, in this way, in this respect, I think this part is really, really different from the other parts. He's talking about it as a difference between grammatical form and logical form. And yet, what he's really saying in every case is, look, I can give you a way of translating talk of justice into talk of things that are just. I can get rid of events in favor of other things. I can get rid of meanings. I can get rid of talk of ideas or thoughts or propositions by just talking about something else. Okay? And that feels different from what he's doing in some of these other cases. Although he's describing that as finding this underlying logical form. Now, I said there was something weird about it. And part of what I think is weird is that if you're going to make that claim, and by the way, nominalists, for example, will want to make that sort of claim about this sort of object. Quine is a philosopher we'll see later who wants to say this about this. All sorts of people would love to get rid of the mental and not face the mind-body problem, and so on and so forth. But now here's the difficulty. You have to give some way of doing it, right? And does Ryle do that? Well, not really. The idea of taking a holiday has just occurred to me. Seems grammatically to be analogous to the dog has bitten me. and if the latter is true, the world must contain both me and the dog. So it would seem if the former is true, the world must contain both me and the idea of taking a holiday. But the appearance is a delusion, for while I could not restate my complaint against the dog in any sentence not containing a descriptive phrase referring to it, I can easily do so with a statement about the idea of taking a holiday. For example, I've just been thinking that I might take a holiday. Yes. So, I can get rid of this talk of ideas, conceptions, thoughts, judgments, etc., etc. Jones hates the thought of going to the hospital. That just means Jones feels distressed when he thinks of what he'll undergo if he goes to the hospital. But now, as soon as I quantify, this gets more complicated. That's why I brought up the examples, I have an idea, or I have a thought. How do I get rid of that? Because if I say, I have an idea, it seems to be suggesting there is an idea, such that I have it. But what if I say, well, here, the idea of taking a holiday was just, that got rephrased as I've been thinking that I might take a holiday. So in this case, right, I have an idea, seems to be, oh, I've been thinking of something. But now that's weird, right? What do I do with that something? It might be that that something exists, and so it's great. Maybe I've got an idea, and it's about that clock, okay? So I've been thinking about that clock. There is an object, the clock, that I've been thinking about. However, often when we say, I have an idea, it's not about an existing thing, right? I've got a friend who's an inventor, and he's saying, I have an idea. Well, it's not that his idea describes some existing thing. He's an inventor. The whole point is it doesn't yet exist. He thinks, I think I could use quantum entanglement to have instantaneous communication. Well, awesome. But, right, that doesn't exist yet. And so the thought of using that to actually communicate anywhere in the world instantaneously, that doesn't yet exist. So it's a great idea, but it's not about anything that exists. So we can't say there is an X such that he's thinking about X. That X doesn't yet exist. And yet, if we say he's thinking that there is an X, well, no, then he'd say, you're wrong, it doesn't exist. That's not right either. So it's actually not at all easy to see how Ryle's idea generalizes to get rid of something like I have an idea or I have a thought. Yeah?
I mean, is a thought like a discrete thing that you could possess? You have a thought?
I don't know.
So is it like another layer on that problem?
Well, maybe, because if you take the naive version and say, look, it just may, I have an idea, there is an X such that X is an idea and I have it, then we can say, well, that's a weird sense of having.
Yeah, right? That seems misleading, like, to have a thought.
Yeah, I have a book, I know what that means, but I have an idea, that's a really different sense of having. And indeed, that's the kind of thing that makes people think, oh, I wish I didn't have to say anything like that, right? Because if not only do I have the idea, which is a mental thing and kind of weird, but now I've got this special relation of having, and I don't know what that is either. We do talk about intellectual property. You can copyright things, you can patent things. So it's like, we do have a legal mechanism for recognizing possession of an idea. And yet usually when you say, I have an idea, it's not like, oh, I should patent it or something. And so what the heck is going on there? It's sort of the object that's weird, but also the relation to the object that's weird. And the same thing is having a thought, right? That's an odd kind of relation, an odd kind of having. So it's easy to sympathize with Ryle's motive for wanting to say, I can rephrase all of these things. But he doesn't give us a method of rephrasing. He gives us a couple of examples. Yeah?
What type of sentences are not systematically misleading?
Yeah, good. You might start thinking, wait, everything's systematically misleading. I mean, and that feeling gets amplified if you've ever taken syntax. You go in, you think, oh, here's a really simple sentence like, this is white. And then you find out, well, it's not that simple, right? You start writing all these complicated things, and you end up with trees. What syntacticians generally do is say, there's some sort of tree structure, here's the sentence, and then maybe we have a determiner phrase and a verb phrase here, and the determiner phrase in this case is demonstrative, and that's the this. And then the verb phrase splits here into the verb, which is, and an adjective, which is white. And as soon as you say, this is white, that's super simple, right? And then you write something like this down, you're thinking, that doesn't look all that simple. And it certainly doesn't look like a very simple sort of subject predicate thing. Well, I mean, in a way it is, but in another way, you start thinking, this is already kind of complicated. So it might be that according to a really good, I've erased all this now, I'm going to start pointing at mice if I continue. But the idea is really, yeah, if the surface structure and the depth structure are, according to your best linguistic theory, different from the get-go, it might be that there's never anything that's not systematic in this thing, which is weird. Well, I think he's thinking that something like this is white is a symbol. Thing that it's not in any way misleading. But the moment you get more complicated than that, it seems like everything gets misleading really fast. Now maybe if I say it's white and cylindrical, that's okay because those are both intersective. If I say it's small, however, that's already systematically misleading in his way of thinking about things. Okay, so some real philosophical issues hang on these things. Do we have to recognize abstractions like justice or triangularity, events like the Battle of Waterloo, meanings like the meaning of the sentence, this is white, ideas, thoughts, propositions as entities in our world? Ryle is trying not to recognize these things. He doesn't want a universe that's full of all these objects. And so there is underlying what he's doing here, I think, an ontological attitude. What is really sort of at the basis of this is not a linguistic theory. Otherwise, he'd say, here really is the systematic way of understanding something involving an abstract term. He doesn't do that. So what's going on? I think what's happened is that he's thinking, I don't want these objects in my universe. Now, he's different from Russell. He doesn't really want sense data in his universe either. So he's not a fan of thinking, this is white refers to some sense datum, you know, in my visual field or something like that. No, this refers to a piece of chalk. And so he wants to be a more common sense sort of realist. But he doesn't like the thought that in addition to that, he has to bring in Plato's forms or this whole realm of events in which these objects are participating or meanings as opposed to the actual sentences themselves. Or these ideas, thoughts, and propositions. He wants a very common sensey world, and he thinks all these things start taking you far away from common sense. We're saying things all the time that seem to be about them. So what does he do? And here he just gives you hints. He just sort of gives you examples. But we're going to see again and again the underlying problem here. And so somebody like Quine, or Carnap in certain stages of his thought, or other people, are going to say, wait a minute. I can give you a systematic way of getting rid of all of these things. But that involves something like this project of translation, or now Russell's theory of descriptions becomes a kind of model here. They'll call this reduction. And so the idea is, can I reduce events to something else? Can I reduce these abstractions to something else? Reduce meanings, reduce talk of these mental entities. If I can, then yay. But I have to do it systematically. I can't say, give me a sentence, right? And so, courage is a virtue. Courageous acts are virtuous acts. Yay. Red is closer to orange than to green. Now what do I do? Red objects are more similar to orange objects than to green objects. That seems less good, right? and so on and so forth. And so you might think, yeah, gee, can I really get rid of all of those things? Yeah, it's not very clear whether I can. And so anyway, we're going to keep fighting about those issues. But part of the reason I wanted to cover Ryle is that he does introduce a sort of, not only the distinction between the surface and the depth form here, but also, in a sense, this project of trying to simplify metaphysics by getting rid of whole classes of objects and seeing in Russell and Carnap and other people the basic strategy for trying to do.